One of my neighbors just got COVID and just knocked her right flat on her butt. And she said that her doctor told her that the variant that's running around right now appears to be really, really nasty. Is it normal for a virus like that to wax and wane in terms of its potency, or is it just, you know, that she was more vulnerable to it somehow? She was fully vaccinated.
Yeah, and I think people forgetting that it's still there. Like, the variants, you know, in certain ways, this winter, like, the peak is not as bad as previous years, only because we actually had a really bad summer. Like, normally we don't have bad summer waves, but this year we had an unusually bad summer wave. And so some people got immunity, you know, again, for like 6 months or so. Some people didn't. And so this winter wave, although the peak is not as bad, there's definitely new variants that are evading. And, you know, in this day and age, any variant that is successful basically can pole vault over previous immunity, over whatever we had before. So it's a whack-a-mole for sure. And some people definitely do have it much worse than others. And but luckily, I think testing is much more available. The $1 tests now exist. The federal government for now is still giving out free COVID tests. Although Paxlovid is not subsidized anymore, and it's much more expensive than before, I recommend people try to get Paxlovid if possible, and stock them up prophylactically if possible. But obviously, you know, not everyone's able to do that.
Sure, I get it. I understand that COVID vaccination rates have plunged over the last year or so. Is this because people think that, you know, they're immune? I mean, they don't realize it's kind of like flu. You know, you've got to revaccinate. The immunity is only temporary. Or is this a consequence of all this right-wing virus fear-mongering?
Well, if the government says the pandemic is over, the people receive the message, and then they think, well, if the pandemic is over, then, you know, don't need to worry about it. But that's actually not necessarily true at all because of, you know, new variants, as we know. And so each year they update the vaccine boosters to be adapted to whatever a variant is circulating. So the boosters went into production in the spring. So that's the most recent variant that we have boosters against. That said, the mRNA vaccine does last, you know, about 6 months. Yeah, in terms of efficacy, it starts to wane after 6 months. So there's this double whack-a-mole. And for those who say the vaccine doesn't work, I still caught COVID. Well, yes, catching COVID is still possible. But if you look at the hospitalization rate, it's 7 times lower. Hospitalization mortality rate, 5 to 7 times lower. Hmm. The death rate, 8 to 11 times lower if you're boosted than if you're not boosted. And so this is where it's really, really important that people, you know, it's not a five alarm wildfire anymore, but it's still incredibly worrisome in the background, and especially if you're immunocompromised, vulnerable, elderly, et cetera.
Would it be fair to say that we've gone from pandemic to endemic?
I don't really like the word endemic, because the endemic, you know, in people's minds is just, oh, it's just a common cold. Mm-hmm. Blah, blah, blah. But, you know, I also want to remind people that flu deaths are, you know, last year were among the highest ever, and flu is endemic. Mm-hmm. And, you know, other places, HIV is endemic to, say, South Africa. But just because it's endemic doesn't mean it's harmless. And that's where a lot of people think endemic means harmless background noise. No, endemic just means it's floating around unchecked.
It's everywhere.
And it doesn't mean it's harmless or mild. And I think this synonym with mild is just completely incorrect. So, yeah, it can be considered endemic in certain ways, but don't make it that misconstruing that it's mild.
Yeah, I totally get it. A lot of people are going to be traveling for the holidays, you know, in the next week or two, huge numbers of people. And if you're going through an airport or if you're on an airplane, obviously, if you're feeling sick at all, if you think that you might have even a cold or a flu, but particularly if you think that you might have COVID. I realize a lot of people, you know, they paid $1,000 for their ticket. They're going to get there, damn it. You know, they're going to get on the plane. Which means that they're going to contaminate people around them. Obviously, if you think you're sick, you should be wearing a mask pretty much all the time to prevent your sickness from infecting other people. But let's revisit real quickly how effective masks might be at preventing you from getting sick when you're going through the airport, and particularly in those tight spaces like airport security and when you're boarding the plane.
Right. And again, in an airport setting, unlike, say, you're with your family, in an airport setting, you're being exposed to so many different people from around the country, around the world, and who could be carrying the virus far and wide. You should really mask up in airports if possible. And N95 masks are best, especially the duck. The best ones are the duck-billed types. Mm-hmm. N95 masks, and if you don't have an N95 mask, at least go with one of the KN95 ear-looped ones. Those are, you know, next best.
Right, but the surgical masks,
they are really
not
effective.
So much, right?
Say again?
The surgical masks, not so much. I mean, they might prevent
the surgical masks, not as much. Look, it's better than nothing, but yeah. The issue is surgical mask is not a really tight-fitting mask.
Right.
Surgical mask, you would have to double up the mask to have a good protection, but I think that's a little bit subpar, you know, expecting people to double up, especially with the gaps in the sides of the mask. That's why the KN95 is better than the surgical, and the N95, especially with the things that have the nose bridge seals, mm-hmm. are much, much better.
Yeah.
They're just so much better in terms of filtration, because the mask wearing is only as good as any leaks, but they are really, really effective, and they're doubly effective if more people around you wear them. But in this day and age, you know, obviously a lot of people, most people don't wear masks, so that's why it's all the more important that if you do wear a mask, it's as tight as you can.
Right.
And especially also in the bathrooms, oftentimes people, you know, have their guard off in the bathrooms. If anything, I say, in addition to airports, whenever you travel or whenever you go anywhere, go in the restaurant or anything, the best place to mask is actually in the bathroom, because bathrooms have poor ventilation. They have bathroom fecal aerosols. These hand-drying blowers that you have actually spread a lot of germs in the air, and that's actually well-documented.
Yeah.
And actually help aerosolize virus and bacteria particles. So bathrooms, definitely try to wear a mask. Even if you don't wear it anywhere else, wear a mask in the bathroom. Honestly, just take it with you.
Yeah, there you go. Dr. Eric Feigl-Ding is with us, the epidemiologist and health economist with the New England Complex Systems Institute. I want to get into bird flu, the Congo mysterious X virus, and whooping cough making a comeback, and perhaps we can even get to polio now that it's become an issue. Dr. Feigl-Ding, you can stick around for just a minute, right?
Yep.
Okay, we'll be right back. Stay with us. It's 15 minutes past the hour.
This is the Thom Hartmann Program.
We're talking with Dr. Eric Feigl-Ding, one of the best epidemiologists in the country, about what's going on with diseases this season. And welcome back. So, Dr. Feigl-Ding, we've saw all these reports of this mystery illness coming out of the Congo, and it seems like maybe it's still a mystery. I'm hearing that now they're starting to think, well, maybe it was just malaria or something. But what's the story here? A number of young people apparently died.
Yeah, this is one of those mysterious things, because it's in a very remote part of Congo. Congo is very resource limited as it is, but this is an even more remote part of the Democratic Republic of Congo. So, and there's a lot of malnutrition there. So it's hard to say if it's a new virus. Like, the WHO has still not officially declared what it is. They sent a team, but they still not assure. It could be a new variant of an existing disease. It's just that whenever people are immunocompromised, that's actually when a lot of diseases can take hold, traditional diseases that many others can fight off. can take hold. So it's hard to say if it's truly a novel disease or just a new variant of an existing disease, mm-hmm. or the mortality rate is higher. And there's been like a couple dozen deaths, if it's just because it's a much more vulnerable population. So we're still in the dark about that. We have no official WHO declarations about this, what it is. So fingers crossed. Yeah. But many countries have actually restricted flights and travel from people who have traveled from that country.
Interesting. I understand also that there's some news lately about they've tracked down some of the animals that were in the Wuhan market and actually found that apparently the COVID that spread around the world started there. Is that nailed down?
The wet market issue is still not nailed down. Like some people say it's that it came from the wet market, although we technically never isolated the virus from that wet market.
Uh-huh.
And if you track the epidemiology of it, you know, as early as October 2019, there were samples of COVID. You know how we test wastewater these days? They found it in the wastewater samples in Italy and France back then, mm-hmm. as well as one child who also had, they checked like the blood samples that were stored. There was one child with it as well, as early as October, November of 2019 in Europe. Mm-hmm. So it's hard to say, you know, what the exact origin of this is. And this is one of my least favorite topics because it becomes so politically charged of was it lab leak or not, or it could have been just a natural virus. Mm-hmm. But we don't actually have any smoking gun of this. So it's at this point, it's pure speculation until we actually have our data, but we haven't isolated the exact source.
I'm about 15 seconds out from a break here. Are you expecting other coronaviruses possibly to jump into the human population from the wild?
Not at the current moment. Mm-hmm. I'm more worried about bird flu, actually. Bird flu right now is the clear and present danger that's spreading like wildfire. And it could mix with other viruses and we'll see.
Yeah, we'll see. Let's talk about that on the other side of this break. We'll be back in just a second here. Dr. Eric Feigl-Ding is with us, the epidemiologist and health economist with New England Complex Systems Institute. You can find him on Blue Sky at Dr. Eric Ding, D-R-E-R-I-C-D-I-N-G, ditto for Twitter. We'll be right back.